If you are in the market for a B550 motherboard, then we have here on the desk six different motherboards in total, including the two very popular successors to the Tomahawk and also Steel Legend series, that is the B550 Tomahawk, as well as the B550M Steel Legend. And then we've got the B550M Mortar, as well as the B550E Gaming from ROG, Strix, ASUS. Then the other two in the mix are the Aorus Master and also the B550 Taichi. So first of all, we will quickly bring up the pricing here, where the cheapest board in the mix is the B550M Steel Legend from ASRock, coming in at an MSRP of $155. It promises an 8+2 phase power design with direct drive MOSFETs. Then we've got the Mortar coming in at $160 with its 8+2+1 phase design with an extra phase for the APU. Then we're moving over to the Tomahawk, which is coming in at $180 MSRP with its 10+2 phase power design. And they're using 60 amp direct drive MOSFETs on both the Mortar and the Tomahawk. So you're getting two extra phases on that Tomahawk. It's coming in with $20 more over the B550M Mortar. But of course, it's also an ATX sized motherboard versus these other two predecessors, which are micro ATX. And typically in motherboard costing, micro ATX does come in cheaper, even if it has all the exact same VRM as the ATX model. That's because there's generally less PCB, traces, materials, and also PCIe slots, for example. So it can help bring that cost down, especially if you don't need it. Then tying the leaderboard here for the most costly B550 motherboards comes from the Aorus Master, the B550 Taichi, and the ROG Strix. So let's get into all these motherboards here today. But also before we start this, I will say none of these boards are horrible. They've all passed the tests. It just depends on who you are and what you're looking for which board will suit you. Let's get into it. So straight up, single-handedly, the most important thing with a motherboard is the VRM, but of course, the ability to handle a CPU. And of course, if you're into enthusiast overclocks, overclocking. So what we're using here is a 3950X, 16 cores, 32 threads, and out of the box, we're just letting it go on all these six boards here. And they all passed the tests fine, I guess. There was some differences, and we're gonna talk about that. But for what it's worth, the VRM temperatures on all these six boards here were absolutely fine. So the Mortar and the Steel Legend were doing a great job of offering you value for money if you intend to get a 3950X out of the box. But what we can see with the Tomahawk and the Mortar, I will pay particular attention to these two because I feel like they won the best value here out of the box, where they're taking the CPU up to 3.95 gigahertz comfortably, and they're doing that with similar wattage to the Steel Legend, where that was getting around 3.9 gigahertz. So it was taking the CPU an extra 50 megahertz higher, and it was doing it so at similar power consumption levels when I measured it from the wall. As for the Taichi and the Aorus Master, they did slightly better than the Tomahawk and Mortar, giving roughly an extra 25 megahertz boost. But I will pay particular attention to the ROG Strix here, because this one was a little bit weird out of the box, where it was only scoring around 3.85 to 3.9 gigahertz. So it did score the lowest with the boost clocks out of the box. And what further complicated things was here was that the BIOS, when I locked in the DDR4, a 4400 megahertz Aorus kit that we're using in today's comparison, just to check the DDR4 speeds, was that this was the only board that when we locked in those AXMP profiles, what it did was it actually dropped the CPU speeds down more for the testing. So I actually ran this test for the B550E Gaming only with default out of the box, as opposed to the other five boards, which were running with DDR4 4400 megahertz. So for what it's worth, all these six boards could support this memory and the XMP profile overclock absolutely fine, but the ROG Strix just had a problem where it was locking in the XMP profiles fine, but it was dropping the boost speeds out of the box for the 3950X. So I believe this is a slight bug. They may wish to correct that with a BIOS update. It's generally not a thing. But of course, when it comes to a comparison, there's sort of like a mass mega review all in one video. I like to report on everything I experience. So if you guys are gonna go out and buy this, you're not gonna get frustrated. You know it all in advance. But what about overclocking the 3950X? Because this is the best in slot for the AM4 socket, you're probably thinking, well, I wanna get the most out of my CPU regardless. I've got a really good water cooler. Is that premium for those top three boards worth it? And here I'm going to say yes, but it was also impressive to see that the Tomahawk and the Mortar could handle the overclocks. More specifically, the Tomahawk was getting the CPU to 4.3 gigahertz, just like the Taichi, the Master, and the ROG Strix E. But it was doing so in quite a weird manner, where the power consumption from the wall was getting 380 plus watts. And when I was using hardware info, it was showing around 240 watts. But when we compare that to those top three boards, they were all scoring around 200 to 210 watts and drawing just over 300 watts from the wall. So the Tomahawk was juicing roughly an extra 80 watts from the wall. And then the Mortar scored 50 megahertz lower. I could only really get this to 4.25 gigahertz at 1.4 volts. So I used 1.4 volt across the board fixed on all these motherboards, and the Steel Legend did suffer from the same problem, but that could only get to 4.2 gigahertz of 1.4 volt. And here the temperatures got quite high. I was not comfortable with 97 degrees on the PCB. And then the Mortar and the Tomahawk were going in the 80s, but this is absolutely fine for 24/7 use. I feel like these temperatures are fine for the Tomahawk and Mortar. It was just the power consumption on these sub-$200 boards were starting to run away. But if you don't care about more power consumption, then the B550 Tomahawk did do a very good job, and I was surprised to see at 180 bucks, it was competing with the other three boards that cost $100 more. Though basically, in a nutshell, summing things up for you guys with the VRM details, if you are getting a 3950X or any Ryzen CPU for that matter across the mainstream lineup, even the upcoming XT series CPUs, then all these boards here are going to be absolutely fine. We tested in 22 degrees C ambient temperatures, but of course, if you get a case with better airflow, you can expect lower temperatures than what we've seen here. But if you are overclocking and you are serious about getting a 16 core and you want to overclock, I would honestly recommend going for the higher end boards that we've mentioned here. But if you're going for, say, a 12 core, say a 3900 XT upcoming, then a B550 Tomahawk is going to be a great choice too. And it's really going to be a sweet spot if you want PCIe 4 and you want to get the next latest and greatest CPU that's coming out with the Zen 3 from AMD. That'll fit into this. And you know the power consumption is not going to go as high as we've seen here with the custom overclocks. It's just going to get better. So what about the onboard audio for all six of these motherboards? I'm just going to put the results up here for you. And I'm going to say they were all pretty good, from anywhere from good to excellent, where I'd say the Steel Legend and also the Taichi stood out with its crosstalk levels. They were phenomenally low. That's all I can say about them. And then we've got the frequency response curves, which were relatively flat across four of the boards. I thought the Tomahawk and the Mortar did start to exhibit a slight zigzag in the upper frequency ranges, but really, if you're getting a mid-range pair of cans, one in particular is the COS KPH30Is. I absolutely love this headset for the money. Super cheap, amazing audio quality. If you get some of those and couple it with a motherboard like this, you're gonna get some fantastic value for money sound, and it's gonna sound really good. Though as for the mic imports, we did see only one of the boards using no noise suppression, and that was the Steel Legend from ASRock, where you'd wanna keep this at a volume level of 80 plus 20 dB. But that being said, if you had to say stream with a decent mic plugged into it, you would be getting better voice quality than the other five motherboards, which were using noise suppression, and it was a heavy kind of noise suppression. And you can basically tell this when you rub your finger or rub your hand on the end and then you quickly take it off. If there is some adjustment there, then that's the noise suppression pretty much adjusting to what's going on. So basically, onboard audio, nothing stood out as bad. If you want to get into professional recordings or professional sound, then you're gonna have to spend some more money. For what it's worth, the numbers were pretty good. Now moving through M.2, all of these have one PCIe 3.0 X4 and one PCIe 4.0 X4, and that would be the top slot on all these boards. Then the bottom slot is the PCIe 3.0. Now, some of them have dual heat sinks, some of them have a single heat sink. Testing out all the heat sinks on these motherboards show that they're all doing their job versus having no heat sink. And I think all the temperatures are absolutely fine. They're comfortable temperatures. I'd have no real qualms choosing one board over another based on these M.2 temps. Though, going through some of the other features here, we've got BIOS flashback on five of the six boards. So in the future, if you buy one of these motherboards and say a Ryzen 4000 CPU, then you can just use that BIOS flashback feature without having to use a 3000 series CPU and worrying about having to get two different CPUs to do the job. Though the Steel Legend, what it lacked for in that BIOS flashback button, it did have a clear CMOS, which was missing on some of these boards in today's comparison. As for USB ports on the back, you're getting a 5+1 on some of them, you're getting 8, you're getting 6+1. For some people, this can actually be a deal breaker. For me personally, if I need more USB ports, I'll just get a USB hub extension. All the boards here did have a single 2.5G NIC solution on board, and then the three $280 boards had Wi-Fi 6 and Bluetooth built in, and then the three sub $200 boards had no Wi-Fi. As for the speeds on the USB ports and the NICs, they're all fine across the board, except for the ROG did exhibit a weird behavior when I first booted it up. I'd have to replug my mouse in if it was on the same port as the keyboard. And then once I've replugged that in, my mouse was able to be used again. So it does look like ASUS have to release a BIOS update to fix two of the problems which I've identified in today's comparison. Now, the last thing we're going to go through is the BIOS and the feature set. Going through all these six motherboards and their BIOSes, they do look different depending on the maker, but when it comes down to it, they've all got the features I need to overclock. Especially with AMD and Ryzen, it is so easy to overclock this thing, though you will be using more power. I feel like they've got the efficiency sweet spot on Ryzen 3000 out of the box very well tuned, to the point where I don't really recommend overclocking to a lot of people on Ryzen 3000. But if you've got the extra water cooling and stuff, then all six of these boards are going to provide a super straightforward and easy experience. Though one thing that's missing from all these boards is RGB control within the BIOS. ASRock do offer this on some of their boards, more specifically the X570 Taichi, which I've seen in the past, but they've taken it away on both the B550 Taichi and the Steel Legend. And then there is the internet update option, which is missing from all six of these boards. So these are two features I love within a BIOS, and they're missing on all of them. But in terms of overclocking the RAM, overclocking the CPU, the fan features, they're all nailed that absolutely fine. And I did have no issues to report whilst I was using the BIOS itself. And with all that out of the way, it is now conclusion time with these motherboards in the roundup. And I think a lot of eyes are going to be on MSI's Mortar and also their Tomahawk series. And I will say, especially with the $180 Tomahawk, it's a nice board. If you go out and buy this, you're gonna have no worries in terms of getting a good value for money overclocking board. But one thing I will point out that I really like that MSI have done this time versus their previous B450 Mortar and also their Tomahawk is that they're using a 6-layer PCB, and they're saying they're doubled up the copper from 1 Oz to 2 Oz. And that definitely shows. Like, I feel like the PCB, the sturdiness, especially on the Tomahawk, it just feels like a really thick, proper board. Whereas opposed to the B450 Tomahawk, I did feel like the PCB was a little bit flimsy. That was my only complaint with the B450 Tomahawk, and they've alleviated that, they've fixed that this time around, and it just makes for such a very solid board. One thing I love that they've done is they've made this IO shield here, the top part, which is usually a lot of the other motherboard manufacturers will just cover that with plastic. They've actually used that and made that alloy and integrated that with the heat sink here to absorb heat and have a functional purpose. So really nice looking motherboard, and also the performance was good to boot. And honestly, if you can afford the Tomahawk for the extra $20, I would get it over the Mortar, which didn't have any RGB. And then we've got the Steel Legend here, which out of the box, it did do a fine job of handling the 3950X. But when it came to overclocking, it was reaching that level of, I'd say, uncomfortable. And so it was the only board here that did, I say, an uncomfortable overclock on the 3950X, where it was starting to struggle a bit. It was okay, but it was starting to struggle. But where this sort of, I guess, competes with the Mortar, for example, is you're getting the RGB up north and down south, and you've got a different aesthetic, which I will say the BIOS did look pretty cool with the camo. But one thing ASRock did do well out of the box was the power efficiency with the 3950X. It was getting around 126 watts as opposed to a lot of the other boards here, which were going up to around 140 watts. It's just the VRM. I'd say they're using a slower switching frequency on the VRM, which is getting the power consumption numbers down out of the box, but that same slow switching is causing it to get a lot hotter, once we apply the overclocks with the 3950X. So with the overclocking and the switching frequencies, if you're into that, it's more of an advanced overclock. You can probably extract some more out of this, but if you are going with a 3950X and you are going to overclock and you do have that expensive water cooler, then you would want to invest, in my opinion, the extra $100 in one of the top tier boards, either the Aorus Master, the ROG Strix, or the Taichi. They all fared very nicely in this comparison. They were top tier boards. They were geared up towards getting the most out of a 3950X when it was overclocked. And they did so with smooth sailing across VRM temperatures, as well as power efficiency and whatnot. So those beefed up VRMs are serving a purpose once you want to get the most out of the 16 core. And with all that out of the way, I hope you guys enjoyed today's video. Basically, when it comes to making a recommendation with one of these six boards, go look at the price and go look at what you intend to do with the board. You're pretty much getting what you pay for, and that is, as you pay more money, you're going to get the ability to overclock a 16 core better. But out of the box, they all fared very well. Though that being said, I would like to see ASUS quickly fix those two problems I pointed out in today's video. Though with that aside, if you guys enjoyed today's video, then be sure to hit that like button for us and let us know in the comment section below which board out of these six, or even out of the whole B550 lineup, do you like the best and why? Love reading your thoughts and opinions as always. Just like this question of the day here, which comes from Saad Shaikh, and they ask, hello Brian, I have a E5 2650 V2. Is this processor unlocked? And if not, what is the procedure? Please advise. Now with the V2, that's essentially an Ivy Bridge Xeon. And now because it's a 2000 series Xeon, they're actually locked and there's no way to unlock the Ivy Bridge second gen E5 2000 series. You actually have to look at the 1600 series, and that was the single Xeon sockets, and you could get some overclocks out of them. As opposed to second generation, it's the same thing with the Xeons. However, the fourth generation is a bit of an anomaly where you can get those 2000 series Xeons to be unlocked to their max turbo multiplier all cores. And we've done a video on this, and I'll put the link up here, where that's the only generation. So the V3 there, the Haswell fourth generation, and then the V2 and the V1, unfortunately, you can't get any more out of them. And then the subsequent V4, you can't get any more out of them either. So hopefully that answers that question. And with that aside, if you guys have stayed this far and you're enjoying that content, you wanna see it the moment it drops, be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell, and I'll catch you in another tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.